who is currently the MIT Catholic chaplain. In the past, he graduated from Yale, has a degree, a doctorate in philosophy from Notre Dame, and in the past was the assistant editors at a journal called First Things. So we're really excited to hear what he has to say to us today. It's going to start by him giving a presentation for, I think, 20 to 35 minutes, and then open up for questions and discussion from the audience. So we're really excited to see what you guys all have to say and what he has to say as well.
So first of all, sound check. Can you hear me in the back? Do I need to adjust this, or are we good back there? Well, thanks for having me. I was telling Father Murphy that this is my first time at Harvard in any sort of official capacity. I've kind of been on campus or near campus before, in Cambridge, but it's my first time here. And so I've got to kind of feel my way a little bit about what the expectations are and what the crowd is like and things like that. Because Harvard's not the same as MIT. part of it is that in all like the television shows and the movies, right? You say you're from MIT, it signals to the audience that the character's smart. Well, if you say you're from Harvard, it signifies that the character's pompous. And I don't think it's quite accurate, because there are pompous people at MIT also. I went to, as you said, I went to Yale, graduated a long time ago in the last millennium, 1994, so everything's different. And back then, when I was younger, I was all into the Yale-Harvard rivalry. But now I'm here, a priest in Boston, and I see all sorts of Harvard people, and some people even come down to MIT for mass or whatever. And so I recognize that I need to be pastoral towards Harvard. So I'm not, like, rather than dismissive or antagonistic or something. So in the interest of being a shepherd to all of you sheep-like Harvard students, just raise your hand and stop me if like there's any words that I use that are too big that you don't understand, or if I'm speaking quickly, or just let me know, and I'll, because I'm here for you to like serve you tonight. I was originally asked to be the second of two speakers, and the first part was supposed to be a Protestant who's going to talk about the Bible, and my job was to talk about everything except the Bible, because I'm a Catholic. However, he couldn't be here, and so I'm going to veer a little bit from just the second part of the title and talk a little bit about the narrative of sex in the Bible. Now, for those of you who have a Harvard vocabulary, narrative just means story. And the story of sex in the Bible is actually kind of simple. It's that sex was great in the beginning, then sex was terrible from the fall until Jesus. Then Christianity, to coin a phrase, made sex great again. But now post-Christianity is creating an alternative to a great Christian sex, which somehow is attractive to young, beautiful, single people and tends to make the rest of society and future generations miserable. But at the end of time, this is how the story ends, when Jesus comes again to establish God's kingdom on earth, when all the dead will be reunited with their resurrected glorious bodies, then there won't be any sex. So that's how the story of Christian sex ends. And let me address this last point first, because it's good to know how a story ends in order to know the story as a whole. The way it ends is, I just read this from Matthew's Gospel. On that day, the Sadducees approached him, saying that there is no resurrection. They put this question to him, saying, "Teacher, Moses said, if a man dies without children, his brother shall marry his wife and raise up descendants for his brother. Now there are seven brothers among us. The first married and died, and having no descendants, left his wife to his brother. The same happened with the second and third, and all through all seven, finally the woman died. Now at the resurrection of the seven, whose wife will she be? For they all had been married to her." Jesus said to them in reply, "You are misled because you do not know the scriptures nor the power of God." This is the punchline. "At the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like the angels in heaven." That's the story at the resurrection, at the end of time. What is the resurrection? Well, Matthew goes on. Matthew's gospel goes on, according to Jesus. "After the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers of heavens will be shaken. Then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming upon the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send out his angels with a trumpet blast, and they will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the other. St. Paul tells us more. We do not want you to be unaware, brothers, about those who have fallen asleep, so that you may not grieve like the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose, so too will God, through Jesus, bring with him those who have fallen asleep, that is, those who have died. Indeed, we tell you this on the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will surely not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself, with the word of command, with the voice of an archangel, with the trumpet of God, again, more trumpets, will come down from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Someone will say, St. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, someone may say, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body will they come back? This I declare, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all fall asleep, but we will all be changed in an instant, in the blink of an eye, at the last trumpet. More trumpets. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For that which is corruptible must clothe itself with incorruptibility, and that which is mortal must clothe itself with immortality. So this is scripture in several different points of telling us that, one, we're not going to have be married in heaven, we're not going to have sex in heaven, but two, we will have bodies. That the bodies that we have right now will, you know, if we die before the things come, like if it doesn't come tonight, you know, we're going to die, and then our bodies are going to go into the ground in some form, but in some mysterious way, our bodies will be resurrected, and they will be like that of Jesus. Is the model we have, right? Because remember, after his resurrection, Jesus was unrecognizable to people in certain ways, to people who knew him well, like Mary Magdalene, and recognizable in some ways because he had, for example, the marks of the crucifixion on him. In the same sort of way, our bodies will be something like that continuity with the bodies we have now. But at the resurrection, the bodies will also be glorious and spiritual and different in some ways that we don't know because we haven't seen them yet. And so that's all part of what's happened, is awaiting for us. It's at the end of time when all of it, you know, the world will be wiped away and we'll get a new one, and only people in it, the only people in it will be those who are saints. It won't be anybody who's a sinner. And that life, and you know, eye is not seen, and ear is not heard, and has not entered the human heart what God has prepared for those who love him. This is going to be awesome, and there's going to be no sex. This is going to be perfect, and it's going to be awesome. It's going to be the best thing that can happen, and there's not going to be any sex. There's going to be no imperfections allowed in this moment, and there's not going to be any sex. And everyone in heaven, as I said, will be a saint. All of those who are, you know, the right hand with the sheep and not with the goats will be welcomed into this eternal kingdom that Jesus will set up. And again, there won't be any marriage, there won't be any procreation. Now, that's something that's kind of tells us that the purpose of whatever it is that we're doing in this life, including marriage and sex, is to prepare us in some way to not have sex. But also, we know that what characterizes that end state of all of us is going to be that we love God and we love one another perfectly. So there's a relationship then between whatever we're doing now and what we're going to become that prepares basically, it's about preparing our hearts to love perfectly. Pharisees approached Jesus and tested. This is the sort of the prototypical example of, or point in the gospel, the pivot between the, where we figure out the first half of the story I told you about sex. It even peeks ahead a little bit to the story at the end. But in the gospel of Matthew, chapter 19, Jesus ties together the way things used to be, the way things are now, and the way they're supposed to be. Once again, when he says to the question of the Pharisees, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any cause whatever? Jesus said in reply, have you not read that from the beginning the Creator made them male and female, and said, for this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, no human being must separate. They said to him, "Then why did Moses command that the man give the woman a bill of divorce and dismiss her?" He said to them, "Because of the hardness of your hearts, Moses allowed you to divorce your wives, but from the beginning it was not so. I say to you, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery." His disciples said to him, "If that is the case of man with his wife, it is better not to marry." I love that reaction. You can't pull a shoot and get out of the bad situation, then it's just better not to get married in the first place. And Jesus answers, "Not all can accept this word, but only those to whom it is granted. And whom that is granted. Some are incapable of marriage because they were born so." The word in Greek is eunuchs, because they were born so. "Some were made so by others, and some because they have renounce marriage, are eunuchs, for the sake of the kingdom of heaven." In which, again, there is no marriage. He's given a marriage. This very complicated passage is moving in a whole bunch of directions. One of them is this pointing ahead, as I said, just indicated to what happens at the end of time. In the kingdom of heaven, people today renounce, for sake of the kingdom of heaven, marriage altogether. That's part of the reason why the church promotes celibacy and says that it is a witness in many respects to the way things will be in heaven. But also it tells us the story that in the beginning there was this original unity and harmony and love between man and woman, the way things are supposed to be, and that because of the hardness of our hearts, because of sin, we don't experience that right now. So a lot of the stuff that we see in the world today, that he saw in his world, pause for a second, but today, a lot of the stuff that he saw, including divorce and the dissolution, the disunity and the disharmony that was that marked married life and the relationship between the sexes, he says that's because of sin, the hardness of your hearts. And then he sets up the aspiration, we can again have the way things, the kind of love and unity that the way things were before the fall. So sex was great in the beginning, sex is terrible today, he says, but it can be better once again. And it's not just, the idea is that it's not just that we say, well, gosh, we're going to stop being jerks to each other, we're going to stop hating each other and start to love each other more, but that actually that Jesus is, like everything else that Jesus is doing, at least when he comes to get rid of original sin and overcome the problems of that and restore us to an even higher place than we were before, does that in general, and does that in the case of marriage? What was that original unity like? In the book of Genesis, in chapter 2, one description of it is that God wants to make a helper suitable for Adam. And he gives him all the animals, and Adam goes and names all the animals, which is kind of a cool thing. There's some people in the church who say that if we ever learned Tower of Babel and the problems, the messing up of languages was created an interesting problem. But if we could ever get behind that through like linguistics and understand what Adam said, there'd be a kind of we sort of understand a little bit more of the unity that we had with all the animals, and it's kind of a cool thought. But that's probably a little more literal than we need to be with the Book of Genesis. But the story we're told is that none of the animals proved to be a helper, important word, suited to the man. The Lord cast Adam into a deep sleep, and then he takes the rib, and he builds out of the rib, he builds a woman. And when he brought her to the man said, "This one at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of man this one has been taken. This is why a man leaves his father and his mother and clings to his wife, and the two of them become one body." The man took his wife, they were naked and they felt no shame, is the last bit. So all these sort of things tell us little bits about the way that we ought to be, says Jesus, by reflecting on the way things were at the beginning. First of all, there's no domination between men and women. She's the helper to the man, taken from him. He looks at her and his first reaction is a love poem. Bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. He clings to his wife. Leaves everything else and clings to her, and then they have sex. The two of them become one body. And yet their sex is characterized and their relationship is characterized by being able to be naked in front of each other. without shame, right? There's no need for clothes. Someone was recently saying who likes to go barefoot and wear shorts all the time says, you know, if it weren't for Adam and Eve, I'd just walk around without clothes on. Wouldn't that be great? I hate them. But there's something, but right, the idea is that we can just, they can be honest with each other, naked, not just in the physical sense, but naked all the way down. They can be before each other without any sort of anything hidden. And you contrast that with the story, what happens right after the fall, right? They eat from the fruit of the tree that they're not supposed to eat from. And the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. When they heard the sound of the Lord God walking about in the garden, the man and his wife hid themselves from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. The Lord that God then called to the man and asked him, "Where are you?" And he answered, "I heard you in the garden, but I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." And God asked, "Who told you that you were naked? You eaten from the tree which I have forbidden you to eat?" The man replied, "The woman whom you put here with me," distancing himself from his wife, "she gave me the fruit of the tree, and so I ate." So again, to nakedness not only makes them unable to be, they're ashamed of their nakedness, and the shame means they can't be in the presence of God or of each other in the same sort of intimate way they were before. And that's part of what we are supposed to be, says Jesus, and that's what we're aspiring to now, that that's what we ought to be aspiring to. It's the way things were in the beginning. And then look at the difference between bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. I'm going to call you woman, and I'm going to love you and cling to you, and you're going to be my helper, and we're going to leave everything else for you, and we have no shame. And the instant disunion. Hey, God, you know, you gave me this chick. I have no idea where she came from. I just fell asleep, and she was there, and you gave her to me, and I don't want her, and she's the one who made me do it, and I'm not really guilty, and she's the one. And then, so there's that instant distance, and that's part of this consequence of sin. And then you go on, and when they talk, when God gives the various curses, he gives a very specific one for Eve. To the woman, God said, "I will intensify your toil in childbearing. In pain you shall bring forth children. Yet your urge shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you." You want to know why women do stupid things for men? There it is. There's a, no longer is she just the helper, no longer is she the equal, the one that that Adam is just thrilled to be with and identifies as like him, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. But instead, he rules over her. There's no longer that same kind of quality. And she wants that. In some sense, your urge shall be for your husband. It's not an innocent loving. It's just sexual, sort of, it's about female libido. And ever since, in fact, it's only recently that it's become sort of common, the common thought that men are the ones who are filled with lust and women are the ones who are sort of innocent in this. And because traditionally, it was always the other way around. Partly based on this and partly based on a whole bunch of other things we probably better off having left behind. But there's a curse that's given to Eve that your relationship with your husband is going to be bad. It's passed on to all, to ruin the relationships between men and women ever since. So that's the end of the great sex. Because suddenly sex is about all sorts of other things. It's about selfishness and shame and domination. Not about equality and love and intimacy. Now, Christianity made it possible to have great sex again. That is, because the Christianity that gives in grace, Jesus says, "I'm going to raise marriage from this fallen state where it's marked by domination and lust and the hardness of your heart and your dismissal of each other, and you know, yeah, I have to have women to have children, but you know, the fact that was one of the at the same time that Jesus was alive, around the same time, Caesar Augustus had to pass laws to explain to men that they had to have relations with their wives because the men were sort of uninterested in having sex in the pagan Roman context. And sometimes they're having sex with other people, men and women both. But even that wasn't even as much a big thing. It's just you have to, you know, once you get married to somebody, you have to do, you have to have sex with them. We're so fascinated with the topic of sex that we kind of want to have it all the time, but that was interesting, that was, things have gotten to that point. And the sacrament of matrimony, right, getting married, gives us a special grace in a Christian context to carry out these marriage promises and to be able to recreate this original unity in some sense, and even improve on it, so that we not only get that original intimacy, but we also have a chance to be like God. You know, the promise that the snake made to, the serpent made to Adam and Eve, we get to be God-like in our love. The love that God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit have for each other and for us, we start to imitate in a different, so it's, we become actually God-like, but in a very different way. Now the deep, deep problem that we still have, or we're going to have, and it characterizes the sex that we have and think about and worry about with our sexuality, is the problem of lust, which is left over from the fall, from what we see, the urge of Eve and the domination of Adam. And Jesus, again, is calling us to get rid of that part of our life as well. So blessed are the clean of heart, the pure of heart, for they shall see God. You've heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you, everyone who looks at a woman with lust, or in order to covet her, another translation, has already committed adultery with her in his heart. This is from the Sermon on the Mount. And then Matthew 15, the things that come out of the mouth come from the heart, and they defile. For from the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, and unchastity in particular, as well as theft, false witness, blasphemy. These are what defile a person. Pastor says that the deed with unwashed hands is not defiled. But what comes from our heart, including adultery and unchastity, porneia, love of the flesh, these are the things that defile us. So part of the goal of what we have in trying to be this kind of person that Christ wants us to be, and marriage is that Christ wants us to have, and to have the hearts that Christ, that we're called to have and are able to have thanks to God's grace, is that we fight against lust. Where lust is primarily a problem of the heart. Lust is traditionally defined as the a desire to dominate another, desire to look at somebody as a means to my own pleasure, my own ends, my own glory, my own vanity, and not to look at them as my bone and flesh of my flesh. So that's the sort of division. And then we have this problem of this post-Christian world where we're in now, and this is the context in which I think, you know, Harvard has their sex week or fornication, lust, what's the sex work? And we're in this sort of world where no one's thinking in these sorts of terms. There's if you've ever read the novel A Canticle for Leibowitz, which inspired the opening bits of Alistair MacIntyre's After Virtue, Canticle for Leibowitz tells a story about how a nuclear war destroyed civilization. And the people decided that the intellectuals were the ones who were at fault. They said scientists were at fault, and then intellectuals in general, and people who could read, and people with glasses, and they started persecuting and killing anybody who gave evidence of setting us down the slippery slope from reading to nuclear weapons. And what's left is this kind of new dark ages. People don't know anything. They know a little bit about the story, what happened, but it's all covered in myth, and they really don't know. There's a moment in the novel in which a monk kind of discovers a pre-war bunker that contains in it a shopping list and a diagram of an electrical circuit, two random things. They don't understand what either item is, but they say, gosh, these come from before the war, they must be holy. And one of the monks actually takes the diagram of the circuit and starts to illuminate it, right? Putting, like in the Middle Ages, they would do Bible, where they draw sort of animals around it and color it and put it in gold and treat this sort of diagram of a circuit in this sort of way. And then later they have there's a scene where they debate the meaning of the words in the shopping list and in the diagram of the circuit with this, what for us reading it is a comic pseudo-sophistication, because we recognize that they have no idea what they're talking about. to them, it seemed like they were really being smart. That's kind of what's happened to us today. We're in this sort of post-apocalyptic world where there's a conversation going on that we know what the right answers are, but there's other people who are having a conversation that seems to them smart, but we recognize they don't know what they're talking about. Or use another metaphor, imagine we're in the same post-apocalyptic world in which some people know what a book is and how to read it, how to benefit from it, and others have discovered, hey, look, this book that you're calling, book, great. It's really good for holding open doors. And if you throw it on a fire, it burns easily. And you can rip out pages and use them after you defecate. They're not wrong. That's the sort of thing that it can be used for. It's just that they don't really even know what they don't know about what it's supposed to be. Something like that's happened with sex. There's a right answer about its purpose. Those who know that answer can sometimes feel frustrated when they're in a debate with people who don't even know what they don't know, but think they know a whole lot. I was going to talk about the metaphysics of sex, which sounds like a big word, but maybe it's one of those Yale words. But the way to talk about it is just that an analogy is, you know, people talk about a glass being half full and half empty, and the glass that's half full is also half empty, and people think the only reason to call a glass one way or the other is a matter of perspective, of disposition. You know, I'm a person who's an optimist, so I say the glass is half full, and I'm someone who's a pessimist, and I say the glass is half empty. That's not the whole story. If you were to go to a pub and order a pint of beer, and the waiter brings you only half a pint, you'd be upset, rightfully so, because the glass is supposed to be full, so the fact that it's only half full means that it's wrong. And the way to talk about it's wrong is to point out that it lacks what it's supposed to have. And that the glass is half empty, therefore. That's how the church looks at all the bad sex out there. You know, it's God, you're supposed to be having this great Christian sex. Instead, you're settling for awful, pornified, transitory, loveless, lust-filled, rapey, empty, risky sex. And we say the glass is half empty. It's not entirely empty, but it's still wrong. It should be full. But of course, if you don't have any money and you want a beer and someone gives you half of theirs, you feel like a jerk for calling the glass, and to look at your glass and say it's half empty, right? It's free beer, and we'll say it's good beer. And you're getting something good, which you might not have had, when otherwise you might not have had anything at all. And so in this case, it's right to say the glass is half full. And this is sort of characterizes, again, our debate with people who don't understand this Christian picture. Right? People have no idea about great Christian sex. Look at sex as a good. Christians don't disagree with that. But it's a partial good. They're happy with that because they don't know any better. It feels good. It fulfills a need to not be alone. It's a price. Sometimes sex is the price for having romantic relationships. Or, you know, I want to have a boyfriend, and I have to have, and sex is part of what you need to do these days to have a boyfriend. I want someone to split the rent with, and this is one part of the price for that. And then there's the hope that through some sort of alchemical process, it might be the beginning of something lasting. If not for life, because that's unlikely, look at the divorce rate today, at least for a while. So part of the debate over sex today is, again, from people who look at the glass and see beer in it and are excited at the prospect of beer, and others look at the half-empty glass and want to send it back because it's not all that it should be. Sex is ultimately, again, as it returns to what I said at the beginning, it's related to our hearts. Not that sex is just a form of cardiovascular activity, but this poetic sense that sex is related to love, and that's one of the ways in which we, who are at the same time physical and spiritual beings, communicate our spiritual love physically. And Christianity is focused on love. Right? When Jesus is asked to summarize everything in the Old Testament, he says, love God and love your neighbor as yourself. And then when he summarizes all the new things that he's adding in his New Testament, he says to love one another as he, Jesus, loves, which he then explains means to love others even more than yourself, to love them in a sacrificial way, so that you sacrifice yourself for others out of love. Love for them in particular, and also love for God in them. And the church has been about this love business for a really long time, and we've taught every other culture that we come into contact with stuff about the human heart and its possibilities, which weren't there before. They didn't know, or they might have forgotten. As Pope John Paul II, St. John Paul II liked to say, the church is an expert in humanity. So when we talk about how awful the sex is today, it's because we're experts in humanity. We know how what it is to love, what kind of love we need to have in order to prepare ourselves for what's to come at the end of time. We know better what it can be. We want to teach everybody and help everybody get there. I think I'm about time to stop. Is there questions you probably have about things that even aren't in my talk but that are generally about sexual ethics, Christian sexual ethics? I'm happy to sort of field those as well.
Christians, since you believe that sex is like a gift and can be good if it's like in compromise of like how what God intended it to be. But I think I just want to clarify how the church and what the Bible says about premarital sex, just because I feel like it's a difficult thing. It came up in a conversation recently, and it's kind of hard to respond to because it just seems like it could easily seem like our views that we see all like sex as taboo, but I just want to clarify how you respond to this question.
Yeah, right. The church says that all sex of any sort outside of marriage, that marriage is the appropriate place to have sex. Because the thing that trains up hearts for what we need, right? It's one, you know, any sort, anything short of that, I mean, you risk, you know, obviously, this, you risk children, you risk disease, you risk, but the big thing is that you don't love in the kind of difficult, permanent way that we're supposed to. The original unity of Adam and Eve was supposed to be without death, even. So they're supposed to love each other without any sense that this is just a temporary thing in any way. And marriage, if you're going to stick with it, is hard. It's an arena of mercy. You're two people who are struggling to be good, who are living on top of each other under all these stresses of the world. And St. Paul talks about why, he says, I wish you were, if you can, it'd be better if you could be celibate because you can devote your heart more fully to God. Not that marriage isn't a path to holiness, just that it's a hard one. And so that's part of that discipline of forgiving. The trespasses of your spouse, just as you want God to forgive your trespasses. That trains our hearts in the sorts of ways we need in order to overcome our selfishness, to think about others, to sacrifice for others, and to be able to prepare ourselves to go to the kingdom of heaven. Now, that's not the way I'm not sure you can slap that down in a bar in a debate and walk away and think you've won, right? You know, dropping the mic after that. But that's the answer. What it is, why it is that this is the kind of this is the place for sex. Everything else is that's what I was trying to get with the metaphor of the half full beer. There's goodness of a residual sort in all that other sex. God made sex and it's good. And so people who experience premarital sex, this is awesome. But they haven't lived their whole life. So they don't really know what their heart's going to be like at the end. And this is why you have to trust people who've been around the block, like a couple thousand years is a good start. This is just a general problem of being young, is that you're not yet old. Right? Your future is still ahead of you. You don't know how things will play out in your own life. Why you can get away with sex week and at Harvard at college, but if you're trying to do sex week at nursing home or whatever, retirement home, they would probably, first of all, they wouldn't be nearly as excited about it. You'd have condom buckets here today, you could have Viagra buckets there, so it wouldn't really get them excited because they know much better the way the world is. Or if they don't, that's another problem. So, right, so part of what you, you know, is that, I'm not giving a great apologetic for a quick debate, but if someone says that, you're like, you know, I don't know what I'm going to be like in the future, and you don't want, but the question the Beatles asked, if you go back to that ancient song from the last millennium, will you still love me when I'm 64? It's a very interesting question, ask the one night stand, or the boyfriend who you're not sure you're going to marry. Well, that's the real question. So you're going to love me forever, at least when I'm, you know, for the next 40 years, when I'm not as attractive as I am today. And that's, you know, young people tend to be short-term planners, not long-term planners. They don't, you know, after, it's been for me, what, 25 years since I went away to college, and now a year isn't that big a deal. If I told you to wait a year, you know, take a year off of college, and, oh my goodness, that's forever, right? So, I'm rambling at this point, but is that, seem like an answer, at least, if not the easy one?
Thanks for being your father. How do you feel is the best way for us to share this as Christians on campus and yet in our lives in general?
Well, part of it is just to know what it is that what you're doing. Like when you date somebody, you're teaching them, if they're not Catholic, or even if they are, you're helping them, or Christian, or, you're helping them towards heaven in some way. And so you have to go about your own, conduct yourself and your own lives in this direction. Another thing is to sort of remember that when you are dating, that the purpose of it is that dating is to lead you to marriage. It's not about these other things. We're dating. It's not about companionship. It's not about fun. It's not just to